فاسألوا أهل الذكر إن كنتم لا تعلمون.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. Dear viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I'm your host, Karim AbuZaid, and this is another edition of Let's Talk About It. Welcome to the show. You call in with your questions, we'll try to answer them. You can also send your questions via email, Facebook page, but let's begin with the phone numbers 1-800-587-9075. And the phone numbers are posted on the screen right now. You can actually give us a call. We are live, dear viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam. 1-800-587-9075. You can give us a call. You can post your question on Facebook page, www.facebook.islamqatv.com/islamqa.tv. You can always send your question to my personal email, karim@huda.tv, K-A-R-I-M @huda.tv, or jannatan71@gmail.com. Or actually, there is Karim also at islamqa.tv. All of these are ways for you to get in touch with us, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Dear viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, we chose the theme for tonight is a continuation of the previous theme, which is actually the divinity of Prophet Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, the fact that Christians, they actually say that Prophet Isa alayhi salatu wasalam is divine. What is the position of Muslims once it comes to this issue? We will certainly also address this subject, inshallah, regarding the divinity of Prophet Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. So 1-800-587-9075, give us a call right now, dear viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam. I hope you're watching. 1-800-587-9075. The way that we go about it is we compile as many questions as possible. The first half hour of the show, which we're already, for technical reasons, we are late. So we only have another 15 minutes, inshallah, to take your questions. And in the second half of the show, we go ahead and simply answer these questions, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. We normally begin with the questions from the old, bi-idhnillah, the old questions that we received. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum, caller.
Yeah, my name is Ahmed. I'm from Toronto, Canada.
Okay, brother Ahmed, Toronto, Canada. And your question, please.
My question is that could you please tell me different types of shirk?
I'm sorry, the line is disconnecting. Brother Ahmed, can you state your question again, please? Yeah, unfortunately, the line is disconnecting, so I invite you, Brother Ahmed, please, to give us a call again. The line got disconnected. I was unable to simply hear your question. But please give us a call, Brother Ahmed from Toronto, Canada. He called and he asked the question, but we were unable to actually get that question. So we'll wait for your phone call and other brothers and sisters' phone call as well, inshallah. So right now we do have some questions from Facebook, from the past, also through emails. And I don't want to forget that I promised Sister Ikhlas from last week to actually answer her question regarding the I believe the black seed. So we'll answer this as well, inshallah ta'ala. As well as we do have our questions from Facebook page and also questions from emails. I'm going through them right now in front of me, and that's why I'm not looking at you, I'm looking at my screen, trying to retrieve these questions bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Let me begin with our sister Ikhlas from the previous show. We promised to bring her some information about the black seed. There is an agreed upon hadith, sister Ikhlas. Okay, let me take that caller and we'll go from there. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum.
Naam.
I got a question. Is this only just particular topic about Prophet Isa alayhi salam, or I can ask like any type of question?
Actually, it's open. You can ask any type of question, but let us know who you are and where you're calling from.
My name is Muhammad. I'm calling from Lubbock.
Where is that?
That's in Texas.
MashaAllah, MashaAllah. That's a long way from here. All right, go ahead. Go ahead, Muhammad.
My question is, what is the problem, the issue of like homosexuality? Like, is it okay to be, if a person, like if a man is like gay or a woman is a lesbian, like it's okay to let her go? Or like people, like I see this man, he's like a imam or whatever, and he's like he's gay, and he said it's okay to be homosexuality.
Okay, and I got your question, inshallah. The ruling on homosexuality. Jazakallah khairan.
Okay.
Barakallah fiqh. Assalamu alaikum wa barakatuh. Okay, crucial subject, sensitive subject, but the truth has to come out. And inshallah, we will answer you bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. So 1-800-587-9075. 1-800-587-9075. I guess Ikhlas will answer her question. I hope our brother Ahmed from Toronto can try us again, 1-800-587-9075. And we do have a couple of questions from Facebook and also from emails. We'll answer those, inshallah. But let me, I guess, as I wait anxiously for your phone calls tonight, let me, inshallah, address the subject. Or a portion of the subject, is Isa alayhi salatu wasalam divine? Brothers and sisters in Islam, what triggered the issue that Prophet Isa alayhi salam is divine is the fact that the people claim that he is the son of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is divine. Now, when you say that the son of Allah, that means, you know, you get some of the attributes of your father. You know, like father like son, they say. Like father like son. You know, if you say a big fish and a small fish, I mean, it's still a fish. You understand, you're getting my point here? So that was the lead that led Christians in particular to attribute divinity to Prophet Isa alayhi salam. Something that he's totally innocent and free from. He never claimed it. He never invited people to believe it. And like I say, subhanAllah, in the day of resurrection, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask him in front of all humanity. وَإِذْ قَالَ اللَّهُ يَا عِيسَى بْنَ مَرْيَمَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will question him, أَأَنْتَ قُلْتَ لِلنَّاسِ اتَّخِذُونِي وَأُمِّيَ إِلَهَيْنِ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ Did you and your mother say to you, the people to take you and your mother as did you say to the people to take you and your mother as two gods, two divine individuals beside me? قال سبحانك glory be to you ما يكون لي أن أقول ما ليس لي بحق. I am not entitled to say that which I have no right to say. So the point here, the Christians claiming that he is the son was the seed for them to later on attribute divinity to him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and gradually he turned into a lord, he turned into a god. You see, that's the whole issue. Now, this is why Islam addresses the issue of him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, being the son of Allah. Now, I mentioned this before, and I will mention it again and over and over again. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above that. Allah does not need to take a son. And you know, there is a verse out there, subhanallah, that I love dearly, which says, قُلْ لَوْ كَانَ لِلرَّحْمَنِ وَلَدٌ فَأَنَا أَوَّلُ الْعَابِدِينَ Say, O Muhammad, if the most merciful, Rahman, Allah, has a son, I will be the first one to worship. If Allah would have taken a son, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would have told us that he has a son, I mean, we do not question Allah anyways. We do not question Allah's action at all. We actually only strive to figure out the wisdom behind Allah's action, whatever Allah does. That's all. But Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling us, was commanded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to tell them, قُلْ say to them, O Muhammad, إِنْ كَانَ لِلرَّحْمَانِ وَلَدٌ If الرَّحْمَان has a son, and he told me that, فَأَنَا أَوَّلُ الْعَابِدِينَ I'm the first one who will worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in spite of this. Another verse في سورة الزمر I also love with respect with regard to the same subject. لو أراد الله أن يتخذ ولدا لاصطفى مما يخلق ما يشاء سبحانه. If Allah would have wanted to take a son, he would have chosen something that is look, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, created the mountains, created the sun, created the moon. Look at all the mighty creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah tells us in the Quran, لَخَلْقُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ أَكْبَرُ مِنْ خَلْقِ النَّاسِ وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ Indeed, the creation of the heavens and the earth is greater than the creation of people. Brothers and sisters in Islam, me and you were created the last thing on a Friday, the last day after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concluded the creation of the heavens and the earth in 6 days. So towards the end of the sixth day, Allah created us. So look, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the rest of the elements of the universe during that time, and our creation, which is in the form of Adam, took a short duration of time. I think the point that I'm trying to make here is Allah would have chosen from that mightier creation whatever he wills to and appoint that to be his son. But in reality, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not have a son. attributing the son to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or children in general, was not introduced only by Christians. The Arabs actually introduced children, attributed children to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they actually done something that is so awful in introducing children to Allah. They said the angels are the daughters of Allah. So they committed two major offenses here. The first one, giving a gender to angels. And we know angels are not males nor females. They are genderless, if I may use the word. Add to this, you know, whenever actually one of them is giving glad tidings of a girl, he doesn't like it. And he attributes the girls to Allah. Huh? Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This is Omar Khlas. I have another question, if you could answer, please.
Sure, inshallah, Omar Khlas.
Okay, I want to know the rulings of wiping over the socks in details. And does it have to be leather socks?
The rules of wiping over the socks in details, and does it have to be leather? Inshallah, we'll answer you with Allah ta'ala.
Yeah, I want to know, is it the same for women and men and kids?
Sure, inshallah. I will answer you bi idhnillah ta'ala. Jazakallah khairan. And we'll start today with your question regarding the black seed, inshallah.
After yeah, I'm waiting for that.
Inshallah.
Okay,
jazakallah
khairan. Thank you so much.
Jazakallah khairan. Barakallah feeki. So, they say, so, look at this. وَجَعَلُوا الْمَلَائِكَةَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عِبَادُ الرَّحْمَانِ إِنَاثًا. And they said the angels are females. That's the first offense. Now, they said that the angels are the daughters of Allah. Now you Arabs, when you are giving the glad tiding of a girl, if your wife is pregnant and she is delivering, and then they come and they tell you, you got a girl. Man. ظَلَّ وَجْهُهُ مُسْوَدًّا وَهُوَ كَظِيمٌ وَيَجْعَلُونَ لِلَّهِ مَا يَكْرَهُونَ. So they appoint to Allah what they hate. You know, they say Allah, you know, has girls when they hate having girls. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Okay, please call us again. Somehow there is something, okay, let me see, something with the Skype tonight, but we'll try to fix it. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Caller, assalamu alaikum. Please, brothers, I see that a lot of you are calling and somehow the line gets disconnected the moment that I try to answer it even before. So please keep trying until you come through to us, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My name is Ahmed, I'm calling from Toronto, Canada.
Okay, brother Ahmed, you called earlier, right? And you had a question, please? Go ahead.
No, I'm different.
Oh, that's another Ahmed, mashallah.
Ahmed, yes.
We have a lot of Ahmeds from Toronto, Canada. That's good news, inshallah. May Allah increase Ahmeds, ya Rab, all over the place. You know, the name Muhammad, dear viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, was the first name of the newborn in United Kingdom, in England. That shows you how Islam is booming in spite of the negativity of the media outlets. Go ahead, please.
Yes. What is the difference between فَإِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا and إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا?
إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا and then what?
No, فَإِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا and then إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا.
Yeah, okay. Adding the fa, you mean? Adding the fa.
Yeah, adding the fa, yes.
Okay, jazakallahu khayra. We'll answer.
I have one more question.
Yes, go ahead.
Yes, the Quran says Allah has begotten a son. What does the word begotten mean?
That he has a son. Begotten means he has a son. Okay, we'll answer you. We'll answer you, inshallah. And maybe we'll answer you as we're talking, inshallah. But we'll answer that linguistic question regarding the fa in the fa'inna ma'al usri yusran, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala.
Okay.
جزاك الله خير brother Ahmed. بارك الله فيك brother Ahmed from Toronto. A different Ahmed. Please brothers you tried to call and you were unsuccessful, you can go ahead and try once again inshallah. So let me go back here. So they say you know وَإِذَا بُشِّرَ أَحَدُهُمْ بِالْأُنْثَى ظَلَّ وَجْهُهُ مُسْوَدًّا وَهُوَ كَظِيمٌ. If one of them is giving the glad tiding of a female, his face will be darkened and he will be unhappy about it. He's not going to like it. Now they attribute the girls to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Arabs started it. And we know that the Jews did this as well. And Allah told us in the Quran, وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودُ عُزَيْرٌ ابْنُ اللَّهِ. And the Jews, they said Izra or Uzair is the son of Allah. The story of Uzair is known in our revelation. Most probably the scholars, they said he is the man who passed by a town or a cemetery or a grave. And he said, will Allah resurrect those people after they have passed away? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused him to die for 100 years, then he resurrected him. The story in Surah Al-Baqarah is known. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi
wa barakatuh. Name, state and question please.
Yes, this is Fadia from Wisconsin.
Sister Fadia from Wisconsin, and you have a question tonight for us.
Yeah, first I want to say Jazakallah khairan for the conference you guys did in New Jersey.
Alhamdulillah. I
plan to day harvest tomorrow. Alhamdulillah, they were able to download it and I was able to watch it. Alhamdulillah, very, very good. Alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah. Jazakallah khairan. Barakallah fiki. May Allah reward you.
The first question is only question. For the Bukhari to buy it, is it better to buy the full version with the, I don't know how many volumes it is, or the summarized version of the Bukhari. I'm not sure which one to get.
It depends on your, if you're a student of knowledge and you want to explore the different wording of one hadith, certainly you should get the detailed one. But if you're someone who is really looking to have an idea of what the hadith and the way that al-Bukhari labeled these ahadith, I would recommend to get the summarized one. But again, it depends on your intention. If you're in the field of Islamic studies and studying the religion, I would recommend to get the detailed one, because that gives you an idea how one hadith is being narrated differently once it comes to the text. Through a different narrator, and that's what al-Bukhari does in his detailed version. Jazakallahu khairan. All right, we took care of our sister Fadia's question. I happened to randomly just answer that. But I'll go back here. So the Jews, because Uzair disappeared for 100 years, and he was known to be a good, righteous person. And he used to memorize the Torah by heart, by the way. And when he returned, the Jews actually lost the Torah, the text of the Torah, the books, which Prophet Musa alayhi salam left for them. So he actually wrote the Torah again from memory for them. And because of this, they called him the son of Allah, because of doing something that is miraculous, is the son of Allah. Then came the Christians, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordained that Prophet Isa is to be born without a father. They called him the son of Allah. Even though, I want to say this, that Christians and Jews, they actually believe all of them are the children of Allah. I just want to let, and this is actually one of the argument that we use when we debate with them. If you go through their Old and New Testament, that word Son of God is used with almost every messenger. They actually consider themselves the children of Allah. And Allah said this in the Quran, وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودُ وَالنَّصَارَى نَحْنُ أَبْنَاءُ اللَّهِ وَأَحِبَّاءُ. The Jews and the Christians, they said that we are the children of Allah and His beloved ones. Allah is telling the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to say, قُلْ, say to them, فَلِمَا يُعَذِّبُكُمْ بِدُنُوبِكُمْ. Why will He then punish you because of sins you committed if you're truly the son of Allah? بَلْ أَنْتُمْ بَشَرٌ مِمَّنْ خَلَقَ. But you're just a creation of Allah, human being created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the thing is, when it came to Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, Prophet Isa alayhi salam, you will find actually the son with a capital S, you know, son with a capital S, right here. Why Isa would take that status? Because of a simple reason, they say that he was not, his birth, he did not have a father. The word they use, earthly father. Listen, if this is the criteria, then Adam deserves to be the son more than Prophet Isa. If this is the I'm saying hypothetical here. Adam is also created by Allah, he's not the son of Allah. Huh? But Adam did not have a father nor a son. Huh? Add to this. Adam did not have a father nor a son. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used this argument in the Quran. إِنَّ مَثَلَ عِيسَى عِنْدَ اللَّهِ كَمَثَلِ آدَمَ خَلَقَهُ مِنْ تُرَابٍ ثُمَّ قَالَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. Indeed, the likeness of Isa alayhi salam in the sight of Allah like Adam, He created him from clay and He commanded him to be, so he was. Inshallah, we'll pause here and we'll now head into answering these questions. We begin with Sister Ummu Ikhlas. She asked last week regarding Al-Habba Sawda or Habbatul Baraka. This is another way to call it, the black seed. We say that Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in an authentic hadith actually agreed upon, and this is the highest quality of authenticity, the highest rank of sahih hadith. When you find al-Bukhari or Muslim agreeing on the wording of the hadith, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, in the black seed there is a cure for everything, every disease except Islam. Aisha is one of the narrators. Other narrated this hadith, but Aisha was one of the narrator, and she asked, what is Islam ya Rasulullah? Qal al-maut, death. So when death comes, regardless, you're going to have to go, you're going to have to go. But now, the Sunnah did not specify which can al-habba sawda, the black seed, be used for. Now, I cannot, and this is again an advice to all the brothers and the sisters who hear such a hadith, I cannot say, okay, you know what? I'm not going to go to the doctor. I'm not going to do my medical testing and find out what I exactly have, what we call diagnose your disease. And I will not use any other medicine but the black seed. Nobody says that at all. Yes, there is a cure in it, like honey. There is a cure. يَخْرُجُ مِنْ بُطُونِهَا شِفَاءٌ شَرَابٌ مُخْتَلِفٌ أَلْوَانُهُ فِيهِ شِفَاءٌ لِلنَّاسِ. Out of the bellies of the bees comes a drink with mixed colors that cures mankind. But the hadith or the verse, the hadith regarding the black seed, the verse regarding the honey, did not specify what disease. So, at the end of the day, we still have to diagnose what we're suffering from, and we're going to try to find a medication that can treat us from that disease, which has been tested and so forth. But al-habba sawda, and this is what the scholars actually came up with, they say it's a generic, and again, the word generic does not mean a brand of, but it's a general cure. They came up with a couple of things here that they say it's a source of energy. If you're running out of energy, so they say the general things, الحبة السوداء will help you. Like some people, they run out of energy when you walk for a while and you see yourself, your breath is already not helping you. Probably the black seed will be a good thing to take every morning. Sisters who are breastfeeding, they say that the black seed helps with the increase of milk and also makes the milk more nutritious in a way. Like I mentioned when Sister Umm Ikhlas called last week asking from the top of my head, because of that hadith, immunity, المناعة. It actually increases the strength of your immune system. Also, it helps children to grow and it helps you to have a control over your aging. In a way, you're still aging. It's not going to stop you from aging, but it helps you to maintain health once it comes to aging. So these are some of the things, Sister Umm Ikhlas, that we could share with you. There is a lot of good work done on this by physicians. Okay, our brother emailed us, buying a medical insurance and tax return. Those are two of his questions. He chose not to to name him, and I will respect that. The first question that we have is medical insurance. Brothers and sisters in Islam, in general, a medical insurance or any type of insurance living in this country, in principle, is unlawful. Unlawful. Any insurance, the conventional insurances. Of course, there are Muslim insurances. There is a way to go about insurances in Islam. And that takes unity of Muslims working together, brotherhood, sisterhood. That actually we dedicate a certain fund, everybody contribute to that fund, and whoever needs help, that money goes to that person to help him. So there is a way to do it Islamically. But what I'm talking about is the conventional, traditional insurance which we acquire in the United States. It falls under a type of a business transaction called al-gharar, bay' al-jahala. That you don't know the commodity, you don't know how much you will get, and so forth. Here is a scenario, somebody keeps paying for car insurance for 10, 15 years and he doesn't even scratch his car. The money he is paying is really wasted. And on the other hand, somebody buys a nice car and he gets full coverage, and then next month he totals the car and he takes the money back. And he just paid 1 month. This is, Islam doesn't entertain this at all, because there is injustice here. Whether against or for one of the parties, the seller or buyer involved in the business transaction. Islam doesn't like these dealings. Likewise, medical insurance. Some people are insured medically and mashallah, they take care of their health and they hardly go to the doctor, and yet he's paying $500-$600 a month for insurance. And some other people consume huge sums of money. So in general, insurances are unlawful in Islam. Now, what makes us then acquire insurance is what is known to be necessity, al-darura. And that's where we apply the rule, al-darurat tubihu al-mahdurat. The necessities makes lawful the forbidden. Now, ideal example, once it comes to car insurance. When you stop in the United States, when you're stopped by a policeman in the United States, the first thing that they ask you, registration and car insurance. And probably you cannot drive without car insurance. But we're talking about liability insurance. We're talking about what? Liability insurance. Then I have to take that insurance because it's a must. There is nothing I can do about it. Likewise, medical insurance. In some cases, it's a must. Let me take that phone call and I will come to the medical insurance. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Naam, name, state and question, please.
Abu Bakr from New York.
Brother Abu Bakr from New York, and your question, please.
Yeah, before I ask you questions, I would like to tell you that I always listen to you and the Danvers and then all your khutbah and the lessons. Make it well for you always. Wallahi, you teach me Islam. Thank you very much. May Allah guide you and give you long life with the Iman.
Jazakallahu khairan, Abu Bakr. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you and grant you.
I need to call you up.
Yeah, grant you steadfastness, Ya Rabb al-Alamin, and Jazakallahu khairan for your kind words. And I truly need your dua, Abu Bakr. Keep making dua for me. Jazakallahu khairan.
Wallahi, because you teach me, Alhamdulillah, since I saw you on internet, YouTube, everywhere I follow your lecture, and wallahi, everything you said, it, I listen, everything, inshallah, Alhamdulillah, Allah let me see you.
Ameen ya Rabbi Alameen. Jazakallahu khairan, brother Abu Bakr. You have a question for me tonight?
Yeah, I have a brother, he asked me two questions because I talked to him about you. I said, I have a chance, I'm asking you, inshallah, to you. And one of them, he said, he was in back home in some place, Jahiliya, they do shirk. They call themselves Muslims, but they do some shirk. He go to fortune tellers and they do some shirk. Things that you know the unseen, you know. So he come back right now, alhamdulillah, he's doing okay. But he told me sometimes he keeps thinking about what the guy says, this can happen. And he's crying, he says, if this still affecting Islam.
No. I will answer you. So basically, Abu Bakr, this is somebody who was involved getting in touch with fortune tellers, and they told him stuff that scared him in a way. And alhamdulillah, he repented. He is no longer doing that. But he's still concerned about some of the things that he was told by these fortune tellers. Is that the question? Or he is concerned about
that? Exactly.
The okay.
Exactly. Like, you go to them, they say certain things that you're going to have this in your life,
yes,
and then you're going to get beat, you're going to get beat.
Yes.
So sometimes you say, he talk come close about this stuff.
Yes.
So he's scared. He's like, I think choking them or what? Because that he's confused.
Okay, I will answer you, Abu Bakr, inshallah, bi'idhnillah. Jazakallahu khairan. Barakallahu feek.
I mean, and I have another question, please.
Sure, go ahead.
Okay, this another guy, he told me, he was working in a place that someone who married a woman. He tell the woman's family and his family and all his friends, they go to masjid, they make a wedding, they make everything right in masjid, the imam make everything already, but he hide in certain people. He's asking me if this is good marriage because he hide from certain people.
So he basically did not announce the nikah to everybody, but to certain people.
Exactly.
And he's asking whether this marriage is valid or not.
Yeah, because I told him, you say marriage must be announced to everybody.
طيب, Abu Bakr, let me ask you, the people whom he hid the news of his marriage are relative to the wife or just regular people?
Regular people, no.
Okay. Jazakallahu khairan. Barakallahu feek, Abu Bakr. I will answer you, inshallah.
Okay, inshallah. Shukran.
Afwan. Jazakallahu khairan. May Allah reward you, brother Abu Bakr. Bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. So now, what question I was answering? Okay. Medical insurance is likewise. There is a necessity. The reason why if you do not have regular insurance, if you do not have medical insurance, and you end up going to the emergency room, you end up with a $60,000-$70,000 bill sometimes, if you have to do like a simple procedure. The whole system here in the United States was set that you have to have insurance, otherwise you're going to be declaring bankruptcy every time you have health problems. And this is a nightmare. So we say that there is a necessity out there. So therefore, the scholar said it's permissible because of this fact. طيب السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Hello.
Now, name, state, and question, please.
My name is Qais.
Okay, brother Qais, and your question tonight?
Are Mohawks haram?
Where are you calling from, Qais? What state you're calling from, and how old are you?
Wisconsin.
MashaAllah. And how old are you?
8.
MashaAllah. And your question again, Qais?
Are Mohawks haram?
Are what again?
Mohawks.
Mohawks. What is that? Oh, the hair? Yeah, yeah. Okay, it is haram, Qais. I want to tell you right away. It is haram, Qais. So don't do it, okay?
Yeah.
Good man, Qais. Jazakallahu khairan. Look at Qais, mashallah. It's haram. He's not going to do it. Mashallah. That's beautiful. When we cut our hair, when we shave our, when we shorten our hair, Qais, it has to be even. We cannot end up with mountains and on our head. But the hair has to be even. طيب, our brother also asked regarding tax return. I didn't really understand the essence of your question. Tax return is okay. I think what you were hinting to, can you cheat to get a better tax return? Is that what you're saying? Cheating is haram. You cannot be cheating. And we say it's haram, that means it's haram to do it against Muslims. It's haram to do it against non-Muslims. So you shouldn't be cheating. You see, I didn't get the essence of your question, but I'm assuming that this is what you meant, dear questioner. Our brother Muhammad from Texas. Brother Muhammad, we do not take our religion from imams. We don't take the religion from Karim AbuZaid or any turban out there. We take our religion from Qala Allah, Qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Huh? Allah said, the messenger said, Brother Muhammad. Okay? That is, you're a Muslim. You submit to Allah, and Allah sent you Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Rasulullah, to show you how to submit. So this is whom you follow. If people come there and pretend to be imams, and they tell you to do things which were not told by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or were not told by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, you're not to obey them. You tell them no. You tell them get out of here. You understand me, Brother Muhammad? Kullun, look at this. Kullun yu'khadhu منه ويرد إلا رسول الله. Everyone you can say no to, except the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. You see, if I say something on this show, and one of you calls me, or emails me, letting me know that this is totally against what the messenger, what the Quran said, I will be having an issue if I don't come back and say I was wrong, and the truth is here because Allah said, the messenger said. Now, we're talking about issues really that gray. We're talking about subjects which are gray. A lot of the questions that I receive, they fall in the gray area, and that's why you're calling. But there are certain things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made crystal clear. Whether they are halal, whether they are haram. This is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in hadith al-Nu'man ibn Bashir radiallahu anhuma fi sahih al-Imam al-Bukhari said, Al-halal ubayyin, wal-haram ubayyin. The halal is crystal clear, and the haram is crystal clear. Tayyib, the question that you asked, Brother Muhammad, and you're telling me there is an imam out there who said it's okay, falls in the area of the crystal clear haram. There is no question about it. Don't even entertain the thought or the idea that this can be halal at any circumstance, at any given circumstances. And I'm making it crystal clear to you, brother. Even if you get a county of imams, millions of imams saying it's okay, it's haram. Al-haram ma harram Allah wa rasuluh. The haram is what Allah and His Messenger said, it's haram. Wal-halal ma ahalla Allah wa rasuluh. And the halal is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made halal. Ya akhi, read the story of the people of Lut in the Quran. And this is not something that Islam came up with. It's actually from the Mosaic tradition, the whole subject. Read it. Don't you read the story of Prophet Lut with his people? And read it in the Quran and what happened to them. So my question to you, brother, my answer to you, brother Muhammad, the subject is crystal clear. There is no shadow of doubt behind its clarity. It's unlawful. And people out there try to come up with justification. Oh, I was born this way. What do you mean you were born this way? Listen, we do understand that certain individuals, yeah, they may have imbalance once it comes to hormones and stuff. But this is your test. You're tested with that. Like the people who love money, they are tested with the love of money. That means you go steal to fulfill that desire? La, you're tested with it. Be patient. Find medication or something, but be patient if there is no... but you can, you know... people may, during their childhood, they experienced it and they liked it. They were forced, they were, you know, molested. They like, that's a test. You're being tested with this. Be patient. We do have desires that our body craves for. But first, and foremost, are these desires, how do we fulfill them? Is it lawful to fulfill them this way? We still have to find what's halal and what's haram. And this is why you say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. You're saying, oh Allah, you are my master, I'm your slave. I'm going to do whatever you command me to do. And this is what is meaning by submission. I hope you got my point without getting myself in trouble. Jazakallahu khairan, Brother Muhammad. Okay. Sister Umm Ikhlas, in details, ruling on wiping over the socks. First of all, let's settle the issue. The Jumhur, the majority of the jurists, they say you can wipe over leather socks and other socks. We know that Al-Ahnaf, the brothers and the sisters who follow the school of thought of Imam Abi Hanifa, they only say the leather socks. But the Jumhur, the rest of the jurists, the majority of the jurists, they do have evidence, Hadith al-Mughira ibn Shu'ba, Ali ibn Abi Talib and others, that the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wiped over cotton wraps on like socks on his feet. So it doesn't have to be leather socks. Now, condition number one, that you must wear it after you have made wudu. Meaning you have washed your feet, that your feet were washed. All right, we still have other people trying to call. I don't know if we're going to have time to take this or not, but let me try. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Okay, hang up somehow. There is something wrong with our connection tonight. We apologize for this, dear questioner, dear callers. Inshallah, we're going to try to fix this for tomorrow's show, inshallah. And I want to let you know that on Wednesday there will be no show because I will be, inshallah, flying to Malaysia, inshallah, for a conference. So Wednesday night there will be no show. There will be only a show tomorrow, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Oh. Naam,
hi, Imam Karim.
Alhamdulillah, how are you doing?
Alhamdulillah. This is Umm Abdurrahman calling from Maryland.
And your question, Umm Abdurrahman?
The question I have, actually, I had called on the second. Jazakumullah khairan for answering my first, the first two questions. However, the last question I asked was that I think that because of my phone, maybe you didn't hear me clearly. I was asking about not like me calling myself Salafi or try to call anybody Salafi. I was asking that when you try to call, you know, family and friends to the Sunnah, and you mentioned like you mentioned certain shuyukh who are associated with the Salafi Dawah or people who are falling to it, and some of the people, but because of the bad image some of those who claim to be upon it have given it, people usually think that you're calling them to a sect. And usually I try to explain it's not a sect, it's just like you explained the first time when you were answering the question. That's what I was trying to say.
Okay.
Like, is there a different, what advice can you give to those who try to differentiate Salafia and Islam?
Okay,
basically.
Well, Jazakallah khair, we'll answer you, Umm Abdurrahman, inshallah, bi-idhnillah. Jazakallah
khair. I have another question.
Sure, go ahead.
Okay, what advice can you give to some of our brothers and sisters who, before Islam, they have what they call, they become vegetarian. And after entering Islam, some of them are still going by this, making haram for themselves what Allah has made halal. And some of them, it's not due to any medical reason.
I got you.
They don't eat meat.
When you
ask them, why is that?
Yeah.
Well, I don't like, you know, the animal being killed for me to eat it.
I got you, inshallah.
So what? Okay,
yeah. I'll got you, inshallah.
Salam alaikum.
Salam alaikum. Salam alaikum. So, Sister Umm Ikhlas, the first condition for your mash, the wiping over the socks or leather socks, that you must have, you must wear it after you make wudu. If you're a resident, 24 hours. But the time kicks off from the first time you break your wudu. From the first time you wipe. So you could wear it in the morning after you pray Fajr, and you could stay with that wudu until mid-morning. And now if you pray Duha, or maybe until Dhuhr, now you make wudu for Dhuhr. So now the time, the 24 hours kicks off at the first time you make wudu and wipe. So with the first wipe. Now, if you keep wearing it and you lose your wudu, you can always wipe. But if you take it off and lose your wudu, pay attention to this. If you take the leather socks off and lose your wudu while the leather socks are off, that means this time is no longer valid and you have to wash your feet in order to wipe again. What if you take it off and you never lose your wudu and you put it back on? And then afterwards you lost your wudu, you can still wipe. That's still valid. Bear in mind also that it's 3 days for a traveler. Like I said, 24 hours for a resident. It's 3 days for a traveler. I hope we addressed your issue, your question, Sister Umm Ikhlas. Brother Ahmed Al-Fa. في اللغة تفيد السرعة الفاء when you see the فاء connected to a sentence It means the quickness in the happening. فَإِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. You know, because the hardship or the calamity is too much, fa, that means the help will come quickly. But the second one, inna ma'al usri yusra, normally came after the help was received. You see? See the sequence here? So the first one, alam nashrah laka sadrak, wa wada'na anka wizrak, alladhi anqada dhahrak, wa rafa'na laka dhikrak. Imagine somebody is going through calamity right now. Hardship. العسر means hardship. Now, fa means quickly the relief will come. فَإِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرِ. But the second one is already, the relief is there. You can handle this one for a while. إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرَ. So it may take some time for the help to reach you. Begotten begets, begat. Begotten, is that how you say that verb? So begotten is the past sentence, I believe, or what, is that right? The past sentence of the verb beget, because it's in the past. So they say Allah has begotten. يؤوده حفظهما. Oh, you see that? Allah doesn't, you know, become tired for taking care of what He created. We hopefully explain this. We answered Sister Fadia. Let me answer Brother Abu Bakr and sign off here, inshallah, and possibly answer Umm Abdurrahman tomorrow. Inshallah, we'll begin with her two questions, inshallah. Sister Umm Abdurrahman, Brother Abu Bakr, قُلْ لَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ الْغَيْبَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. This brother needs to increase his faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If this brother explores the study of the belief system in Islam, you know, he will not go through this. Basically, you end up at the hand of a fortune teller, and then you believed him, and he's telling you that you're gonna go through all type of hardships, and you believe in that person. Come on, man. قُلْ لَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ الْغَيْبَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. The only one who knows the unseen is Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not that fortune teller, not me, not you. Huh? Add to this, Brother Abu Bakr, anything that befalls you, Allah must decree it. Allah must decree it. So he could have told him certain things. If he places his reliance and his trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that will help him. I still say that marriage contract is valid. As long as you made an announcement, and there are certain people that you don't want them to know about it, as long as they are not crucial in the sense that they are part of the family of the wife or part of his family, basically, the objective or the wisdom of announcing a marriage contract, so that when people see you and your wife walking together, they know that you're married, that this is not a lawful relationship, that these guys are walking around together in out of wedlock. Now, of these people are not important. We say that the marriage contract still valid. With this, inshallah, we have answered Brother Qais. May Allah reward him, our 8 years old, and he's not going to do that. He said, what, Magoon, something like that? Huh? Mohawk hair style. Don't do the mohawk hairstyle, Qais, okay? Jazakum Allah khaira, dear brothers and sisters in Islam. With this, we will sign off tonight, inshallah. Tomorrow night, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, we will have one more show this week. Wednesday, we're off because of my travel, inshallah. Till the next edition of Let's Talk About It, I leave you in the care of Allah. Till then, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.